Yeah, we're being recorded. So much for those controversial statements that Scott wanted to make. In any case, welcome everyone to this panel. So I'm just going to find my notes here, then we'll get going. Where's it gone? Oh, there we go. Yeah, so welcome to this panel. So our topic is application experiences with online data analysis and reduction. We've got five splendid panelists and lots to cover. So I'm just going to say a few words of introduction and then get things going. So I'm Ian Foster, a scientist at Argonne and a faculty member at the University of Chicago. I have a strong interest in the topic of this panel, not least because I lead the ECP Co-Design Center for Online Data Analysis and Reduction, or CODAR. We proposed CODAR to ECP because we saw that exascale applications and architectures would increasingly require running different applications, data analysis codes, data reduction codes, concurrently, exchanging information online rather than being coupled via the file system, as perhaps used to be common practice. So over the last few years, CODAR has been working with a range of different ECP applications to develop and apply new data analysis methods, data reduction methods, component coupling tools, and related technologies. So we're not going to go through and describe those technologies in this panel. Instead, we've got a set of scientists who all have been facing the need for online data analysis and reduction in their work. I'm going to ask each of them to briefly introduce themselves and explain why these problems are of concern to them. And then we'll ask questions. I've got some questions lined up, but hopefully the audience will come up with other and even better questions. And Scott Klasky in particular has asked that we come up with controversial questions for him. So let's get going. So perhaps I'll simply go alphabetically. So first of all, C.S. Chang, would you like to introduce yourself and just say a few words about your interest in online data analysis and reduction?
Yeah, hi. I am heading up a fusion SciDEC project, multi-scale, nonlinear, multi-physics simulation of fusion edge. And also I'm the co-head of ECP whole device modeling. And my interest has been working with Oscar scientists, data scientists, and the performance engineers to get this humongous job. I have a scientific job. I have I'm running well on exascale computers because we absolutely need exascale computers. And I have been leading a large group of FES and Oscar people, 17 years or something. So this has been my job actually to push the Oscar people to meet the needs of our application science in extreme scale computing and data analysis. We need data analysis, especially as computers get big. We all know that the computers get big, but the file system doesn't. There's a problem. We cannot really analyze the data we want to see, especially in nonlinear dynamics. The particle interaction with turbulence is the most important basic science, how they interact in phase space, in our case, 5D phase space. And that's a very expensive analysis. That's not actually possible without the technology we are talking about. Okay, so that is my short introduction. I'll get into a little more detail later.
Yeah, okay, thank you, CS, very good. Well, let's move on. So Axel Hubel is our second panelist.
Thank you very much. I'm Axel Hubel from Berkeley Lab. I'm part of the WebX team, and what we are doing is we want to research the future generation of particle accelerators for high energy physics. And how we do this is we write large particle and cell simulations and run them on the full system size if needed, because we need to model like large scale length of plasma and interaction with lasers, but have to resolve the small wavelengths and the small interaction frequencies that happen in between and the evolution of everything. Why is this important for us, and why is data a problem here? The challenge that we see is that our simulations easily can fill 10 to the 11, 10 to the 13 particles. And just writing them out, if I want to have what I could do like 5 years ago. So I'm a junior researcher, but I worked in this field before as an undergrad. What I could do like 5 years ago is like I could still write out my whole simulation, look at 20 time steps, 50 time steps, and understand something about this. That was great. But if you do this now, every simulation is half a petabyte to a petabyte. That is not extremely fun to analyze. And the challenge that we face is we do two things. We research fundamental processes in laser plasma interaction and laser plasma evolution, but we also want to optimize the end of the machine, the particle accelerator. And for these optimization processes, we don't need to go to the petabyte of data, find the right particle and optimize them. Right? There are a lot of things that we can by default try to analyze on the fly, but we have to know what to look for. And it's both a challenge that's interesting for in situ analysis and preserving the right quantities, but also for workflows, right? How do we arrive at actually setting the right parameters and steering them for an online in situ analysis if we couldn't have simulated the problem before? Because the physics is not the same if we unresolve it. So we can get like, we have to really derive workflows. How can we estimate this properly, both from theory that we have, from modeling, from small simulations, workflows with reduced models, to the full simulation that we actually want to optimize for? And yeah, so this is a little bit a quick pitch about the directions that we're looking for. Then on this journey, I worked for many years already with large data IO frameworks like Adios, for example, but also in situ reduction, in situ visualization. Everything I want to know about my science, ideally on the fly.
Very good. Thank you. Rob Jacob.
Hi, my name is
Miami Airport.
Yes,
oh, no, he's not. He's in the machine
Tampa
room.
Airport. I'm in the ENIAC machine room. I'm a climate scientist at Argonne National Lab, and I lead the infrastructure group for the DOE climate model project, the Energy Exascale or System Model. We've been working on climate models for over 20 years probably. And climate modeling is primarily concerned with generating very long multivariate time series of climate interaction. We'd like to get typically 100 years worth of climate interaction, and the time step is typically 30 minutes. The grid sizes are still not very big. We might be orders of millions or tens of millions of grid points. So we still kind of write out all the grid points for many of our variables. And we have made some inroads into in situ and online analysis for various diagnostics that would be a pain to calculate post facto after the run is done. But climate has not made a lot of inroads with compression, except where it had to, because there simply isn't enough disk space at the site that we're running on.
All right. Well, thank you, Rob. Mm-hmm. Next up, I guess, Scott Klasky. Who has a slide? Excellent. Good.
Now we need to unmute Scott.
Take it away, Scott. We've got Scott's slide, but not Scott.
Apologies. Right. So what I'll say is, so I know the panelist, and I'll describe my history here. When I first became a graduate student, I met Rob Jacob. I was in general relativity. And at Texas, we had this Cray YMP. It had an SSD. Most people don't even realize systems back then did. So what you're looking at is a 2.7 gigaflop processor with a 13.6 gigabyte per second SSD. And I was in relativity, and everything we did was through an IO abstraction because we needed to understand how to coalesce black holes. And that became my PhD thesis. So we had to do in situ viz. We had to do these things because this is how we really discovered, you know, the algorithms. Later on in my history, I then, right after 2002, I believe I met Ian Foster, and we were on a fusion collaboratory project. And during that time, I was starting to examine the IBM SP2s were out. We were using those. We were starting to say, well, how can we take this really large information and then provide feedback to the simulation? Although after that, before this Cray XT5 came out, I met C.S. Chang, and he had this grand vision of coupling these applications, having more analysis. And we said, well, how do we create this infrastructure to do that? And then as we got to this Cray Titan computer, then I met this young student, Axel, who is over in Germany, who said, we know how to do everything. So that became an interesting thing, and Axel remembers, and it became a great collaboration of where we started to really examine how do we really get fast I/O, but also how can we do more of this in situ processing? How do we look at more reduction? And, you know, I saw Axel go from, you know, a grad student to now he's like, you know, one of the leaders in his field, and that was great. And along the way, then I met, you know, I met Todd and started talking about reduction. So along in this entire thing, as we go now, and again, this is a somewhat Oak Ridge perspective, obviously, but as we go to the first US exascale computer, we're just, you know, we can look at this and say 10 terabytes per second is our burst buffer storage. Most people can't use burst buffers effectively on Summit. I think we know the reality, but you know, we know how to do things. But when we look at 10 terabytes per second to 13.6 gigabytes per second, we can say, hey, we went up, we went up three orders of magnitude. That's great. But 2.7 gigaflops going to 2 exaflops, you can see that we kind of really understand that we can't do things as we do today. So I partner with so many different applications to say, how do we overcome this? And if I said the one thing that I've learned through this entire process, like later, I remember meeting Arvind and you guys were working Deep Drive MD, and we said, well, this is an interesting problem. And a lot of the things for, I would say for, I don't want to distinguish so much between files and within memory. It's more of how do we process information? How do we reduce information? How do we make near real-time decisions? And through all the different sciences, I think they have a lot of really good things that can be done, and the Oscar community can contribute to all these projects. All right. I'm done.
Thank you, Scott. Okay, and last but least, Arvind Ramanathan.
Sure. I'm a computational biologist at Argonne National Lab. Also have joint appointments at University of Chicago and so on. As Scott was mentioning, we along with Shantanu and Ian and a whole bunch of others have been developing Deep Drive MD, which is to look at how we can drive simulations that are guided by AI and machine learning. And obviously that requires a lot of online decision making because you want to basically sample the portions of the landscape that is most interesting for you. So we try and build those algorithms using a variety of surrogate models, where IO is actually kind of important and online manipulation of data or transformations of data is actually kind of critical. So.
All right, well, thank you. So I'm going to, pose some questions to our panelists, but I would encourage other people to ask better questions, and probably you'll be able to try and stump them with questions that they weren't aware that I was going to ask already. So that would be even better. But you know, we've heard from these different groups. Some are clearly quite advanced. They're using online data analysis and reduction regarded as fundamental. Others perhaps are more exploring what can be done. So maybe here's a very open-ended question for anyone who wants to answer. As you've started to, you know, apply these techniques, what were the things that surprised you? You know, what turned out to be particularly, I don't know, useful, difficult, challenging, easy, very open-ended?
Okay, I'll go first. The thing that surprises me half the time is when you can do I/O really efficiently to storage. And, you know, again, I can take so many applications, but when you can do it, sometimes storage is faster than going through these different memory techniques. And that was surprising, but I'll comment that, but variability is less, and I think that's still important, but that was a surprise to me.
So when you say storage is faster rather than going through memory, you mean writing to disk rather than writing to perhaps a RAM disk or?
So what I mean by that is there's reasons for it, which I won't get into, but if you're actually using, say, GPFS, if you write files, a lot of times things are cached and the file system can do things to give you more bandwidth. I partially blame vendors for the poor support of RDMA. And I think a lot of the IO community knows this. So, you know, they need to fix a lot of that. But it was a surprise to me that, you know, as we've been running experiments, we see this at times.
Okay, thank you. I see Axel has his hand up.
I actually want to first chime in, Scott. I think the situation is even more dire because what we showed actually, and I have a little performance model on that one, is that even if you don't have all the problems that it could be in the network, even if your data reduction algorithm is too slow, even then you will effectively lose time and will have a longer time to solution for your application. Actually, we did analysis on Titan at the time and still use the results on some of the other machines now. It's a good example. Actually, most compressors are actually for us too slow, at least for the current file systems, to be effective enough to reduce our time to solution, they reduce our data size. An obvious example is like Zlib, for example, right? That's actually a very slow compressor, even if you parallelize it on the CPU and do all your computing on the GPU. That's one case.
So you're saying that, you know, if you were to just write out the data uncompressed, that would ultimately take less time than compressing it first and writing out the compressed data.
Exactly, yeah. And we can actually do the math. Is actually, at the end, it's a very easy relation between how much is the compression ratio versus how much is the throughput we have per analysis stage. Mm-hmm. And with that, we can derive really a criteria when we get backlog in a whole data analysis pipeline. So it could be one stage, could be arbitrary. And that's something you have to be aware of. I was definitely surprised with it as well. Actually, I wanted to add a new thought for that, what surprised me. What surprised me is even when we have this pipeline set up, there are new problems arising. Like, for example, for each of these stages that we have to manage memory, suddenly be aware of them. And they are actually quite, how much memory we have where for individual reduction stages is quite diverse between different machines. And that's something that's actually then quite challenging for like an application scientist that just wants to say like run on Titan or run on Summit and not run on Perlmutter. And then suddenly you actually have less burst buffer, you have less RAM on the host compared to GPU. And suddenly you have to rethink your workflow. That I found surprising.
Thank you. Let's see, Arvind, you have your hand up.
Sure. I think my comment is probably going to reflect a little bit on what Axel and Scott were saying, but I think one of the important things that we realized was that what I call the semantic difference of implementing online workflows I think there is something to be done with these programming constructs that need to be made easier for writing or realizing such workflows on any system of choice. And with the heterogeneity of the systems that have come in, this becomes even more prominent. So in some cases where we have looked at these differences is when we bring machines like Cerebrus or the AI test beds that we have at Argonne. If we were to think a little bit about how we write these workflows where it'll help us have these fast throughputs on data and things like that, I don't think any of these hardware vendors have paid attention to that sort of you know, combining these heterogeneous resources. And I'm not putting them under the bus in some sense. There is a lot of developments going on, but you know, it's something that's very important that we don't have constructs in the programming language way that helps us build these sorts of workflows in a unified manner.
And it seems that machines are becoming more rather than less heterogeneous. So that
problem
isn't going to go away in the short term, at least.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so CS.
Let me approach the question from a little different feature as an application scientist. The online analysis collaboration with Oscar scientists, I'm a little bit surprised, maybe a lot surprised, how different it is from the usual, the past post-processing collaboration. It's a new area. The codes we are talking about is huge, humongous. And for example, we have, even at the moment on Summit, we use trillions of particles. Can't analyze all of them. And how important it is to work together with the data scientist, by the application scientist. It has been a little surprising. It is extremely important to, for example, to get which part of the automated online analysis they need, and how not to hurt the main, for example, the expensive simulation, not to slow down or not to occupy the memory size. And these are all very, very delicate things and important things. And also the mathematicians or data scientists think about something simple when they go do it. But in our case, I'm sure that there are other application scientists has similar problems. For example, to identify what kind of turbulence modes is important in giving this kind of behavior to the plasma, we need to preserve the phase space structure in 5D or 6D, not only conservation of energy. And we doing that kind of thing requires a lot of interaction and collaboration with the Oscar scientist. Otherwise, expensive simulation, spending millions of core hours will be just wasted, you know. So I'm really surprised, also concerned that how tightly we have to be integrated together to get this online analysis done, and then online data reduction to be done to get to be relevant to what we do and to be very useful to us.
Yeah, no, this is a fascinating thing for me, as we've been learning, is it's compressing scientific data is not just a question of firing up GZIP. You need to take great care to preserve the things that are important in the data, and that can vary according to the application and your intended downstream uses, right? Yeah, any other comments? It's hard to know. Scott, have you got your hand up again? Is that right? Yes?
Yeah, so my comment is, I think, and this is what CS and others say, whenever you're trying to deal with like everyone here is pretty much bleeding edge. And whenever you're trying to deal with bleeding edge computing on bleeding edge computers, I find it like, of course we need tighter integration. You guys are the pioneers. And, you know, when we're putting together all this technology, that was the whole reason for ECP, that you do have to have tighter integration. So I'm saying, I'm not surprised by that. I think for a lot of people like I work with who are not doing bleeding edge, I know, for example, that there's a bunch of scientists in Israel. They took some of our technology, they put it in the WRF code, and then they wrote a paper saying how good it was for this. And that had reduction, online reduction, and it had some various online analysis. But they're only running off of like 20 nodes or something, which is why it's easy. So I'm saying whenever you're bleeding edge, yeah, expect that that's the point of CIDAC, that's the point of ECP.
So here, I mean, if there's a follow-up question maybe for everyone here is, as just said, you know, the point of the programs that DOE establishes, like CIDAC and ECP, is to establish these partnerships and which advance both the science and the technology. But you know, ultimately, if we want these techniques to become broadly applicable, they have to be things that will just work and that you can, you know, like you don't need an MPI scientist to use MPI, to use a trivial example. So what do we need to be doing to reduce these barriers to broadly applying these ideas? And Axel, you have your hand up.
I think that's a good question to ask, because before we ask the question about what's the technology that we want to use, is actually what's the question that we want to ask. And what we try to approach this with is to actually first describe from the domain science side what would be kind of the API. I mean, it doesn't have to be an API in the sense of the to see API that goes in, but what is the interface I want to talk to? What do I want to be able to express? So for example, to take an easy workflow, what we quite often do for particles is like correlate, filter, and then project, right? So our particles live in 3D space, but effectively they're like in a 6D phase space and evolve over time. And what we're looking at is phase-based projections, for example. And then we look for particles and for dynamics of interest. And if the geometry is complicated enough, it's not as easy as taking the x-axis and the x-momentum and putting a histogram, but it's that more. And so thinking first about what is actually API, how would I express it in my application code if I could already do it, and then finding the abstraction behind it, I think is one direction one can go there.
Yep. Okay. Thank you. Any other comments on that question?
Yeah, in my mind, in my experience, the managers of you know, it doesn't matter ECP software project or CIDAC, when they demand actually to publish papers together in scientific area and show proofs, and they do demand, they do push it a lot, but I think that should be pushed a lot more. Otherwise, say, Ian, you say, okay, I develop a technology, go use it. And that's application scientist. They have a tendency not to go into something new unless they know it's useful. that is one issue, especially physicists. They're not going to take anything unless they know it's going to help my research. Right?
Yes, of course. Yeah.
So that is very important. Published together in scientific papers using your technology, and if you can push that, the members into that direction, that's going to help a lot.
Right. Rob.
Yeah, I remember working with some climate scientists who were new to modeling and were complaining that to use MPI, you had to become a bit of an MPI scientist. but at least you knew that there was just one choice for what you had to learn. And I think there's still such a zoo of different libraries and approaches out there that even if you're willing to walk up a learning curve like that, you're not sure which one really is the right one for you.
Okay, thank you. So maybe I'll take things in a different direction. So, you know, one reason, as we've heard, for using online analysis and reduction is simply to accelerate your application or your analyses by performing them at the same time as your simulation is running. But you know, another maybe in some ways even more exciting thing is to use the results of an analysis to in a sense steer the next steps of your application. You know, to establish feedback loops of some sort or another. Do you see the various of you see that happening in your applications? Scott.
So I told CS I would field this one for him. And I'm assuming that at some point who'll put this movie of these homoclinic tangles. And what I'm trying to say is, what I'm seeing is that as scientists embrace the technology, all of a sudden, like, we start thinking, like in his case, we have to think where we're going to do some seeding, and he can describe it. I'd rather not have to. But the point is that there's a lot of things that we can do better. Right now, we don't have this, but then working with some of the visualization people, et cetera, we can see we can have better ways to do the seeding such that we can have this feedback which goes into the other analysis processes. So it's not the feedback, Ian, that you're talking about, but it's feedback where one analysis process can determine where there's things like, you know, there's more entropy, and then we can think maybe we see there, we can feed back, so we can create these very complex online workflows. And maybe it doesn't go back to the application, and maybe it does. I think in the does, it would be more in some of the performance work, online performance analysis that, I mean, we've explored with CS. So there's things, but I think we're still in the beginning phases.
So maybe, I mean, Arvind, I know your application has those features. Maybe you could just say a few words about that.
Yeah, I think some of the aspects that, you know, go back to this one paper that Shantanu wrote a few years back with others. It's about how you think of the AI being interfaced with the different sorts of codes that you have. So in some cases, the AI might just be analyzing the data and it's not doing anything other than passive monitoring of certain states, you know, for example, or some information in a simulation. In some cases, it might be actively monitoring the states and then trying to steer where it needs to go. In some sense, it's actually on the outside. There is a loop that kind of keeps running. And in occasion, you might have both of them going on. You're building a latent model or a surrogate model that helps you steer the simulation. But there is also the need to check where the machine learning is making mistakes and so on. So I think there are some characteristic, notion that we can sort of annotate these simulation types. And that comes about with this, difficulty of actually like trying to implement them all, because you don't have a way to checkpoint certain things. And currently, if a workflow fails, you just have to goodbye. You just have to just stop the entire workflow from running, which is kind of miserable for application developers. And although some strides are being made in the direction, I think there is quite a bit of work to be done, because even the programming constructs that exist today for some of these workflows are really very poor.
So there's real software productivity challenges.
Yes,
you would say
definitely.
Right,
definitely.
Which is, in general, programming, deterministic programming is much easier than non-deterministic programming, and it seems there's in a sense in which these online analyses can make your applications non-deterministic.
Yes,
absolutely. And we need ways to control that. Have people got thoughts on how that can be done most effectively?
I can sort of opine on that a little bit, but I'm by no means a programming languages guy. So just don't, shoot the messenger here. So one of the ways we have been exploring that is to try and see what can come out of these differentiable programming models. So, what is a common currency between simulation codes and machine learning codes? They all somehow operate on gradients, and we are making operations on gradients as one of those, basic units of function. So if we were to use differentiable programming and we are able to link the internal structures between a simulation code and a machine learning code, that offers some principled constructs against which we can go after. So we will basically say, this is a structure in which these two things should be coupled. And that is one thing that I've seen in the literature where people have developed some things like JAX-MD, where you have just-in-time compiler that links up the MD simulation code with the machine learning code, and it sort of helps you do certain things in a way that is not possible before. So JAX-MD kind of allows you to interface with Torch or any other types of, you know, deep learning models without having to ever suffer through this process of, you know, having to write glue code, which is like 95% of the time that we have to do. So that's something that we are looking at. And thank you. Others might have thoughts.
Axel?
Yeah, I fully agree. I think that's definitely also the moment that you go into the design direction and you want to optimize for something for highest energies, for best emittance, for particle beam, for example. That information would definitely be extremely helpful, but it's a lot of more compute compared to what we currently have, and also memory intense. So yeah, if we go that direction as a community, we definitely have decades to come to compute again on smaller problems. Right. But it would be really interesting.
Yeah, I mean, one thing this conversation makes me wonder is, you know, a topic of great interest at the moment is reproducibility of research. Do you see new challenges arising, you know, due to online analysis and reduction, or at least feedback loops based on that in particular? Did you put your hand up again, Axel? Is it still?
Yeah, I'm happy to comment on that. Both aspects, feedback loops as well as online reduction, I think that's indeed a big challenge, because we cannot, even if we want to, share the output of our simulations quickly and let someone else check our analysis if we did something wrong, calibrated something wrong. I think we have to really address this quite holistically. So the workflow that we develop for our in situ reduction, including the software we ran and all the input, we have to make as reproducible as a whole as possible. Otherwise, I see very little chance to get something out, because at the end, if we publish a face-based histogram and say like, this was the best result that we got out of, how how did we get this? And specifically, if you ran this on the currently one of the largest machines that are available. I think the good thing is that every workflow that's heroic today will in 10 years be reproducible, but only if we lay the foundation today and make our workflow reproducible. It might be that we have to continue maintaining the code until then. Sure, that's all good and fine. But if we don't know what we modeled, then it gets really tricky, and what all the steps that we did to do something on the fly.
Yeah, interesting. Okay, yeah. Arvind?
Sure. So I think online data reduction is always one of those things that can add some more non-determinism that, you know, you already mentioned. So I think, you know, there is this aspect of reproducibility which comes from multiple angles of, you know, how you couple these workflows. And so in the folding example, as you saw, we had to like run these, you know, simulations at least 10 to 15 times so that you could bound the amount of uncertainty that you have. And I think this brings about some intrinsic aspects of these workflows, where if we can assign or theoretically model the uncertainty, which is doable, that would be an awesome way to like make sure that you have more reproducible code and more reproducible workflows at the end of the day.
All right, thank you. CES?
Yeah, in my mind, if you talk about feedback to the simulation, I have two things in mind. One is near real time, that is simulation, guiding simulation for the next simulation using near real time monitoring the simulation and result. What I'm pursuing at this moment in the near future is actual real-time feedback to the simulation. For example, it doesn't matter, there was Tim actually talking about grid code and not only particle codes. There can be a simulation, expensive exascale simulation can be destroyed by some grid instability or non-resolved physics where we found the interesting physics is there. And we want to automate that, you know, that kind of feature. And also, we do know application scientists, experienced people know there are numerical instabilities, specific ones we know of. If those things happen, we want to filter them out so that we don't throw away the simulation. Right? And we would like to have the real-time automated steering of simulation. If I need more resolution at one point, one part where interesting turbulence is occurring, when I in you know AMR, use AMR particle or grid AMR there, and increase the resolution there to not to throw away the expensive simulation, for example. I'm more interested now in getting into real-time steering feedback to the simulation, you know, without human intervention, intervention, and using there, we have to use AI and ML too.
Okay, interesting, yeah. Cool. Scott, you had your hand up.
Yeah, the one part that I guess coming from my background that wasn't mentioned as much is it's all about this. If you're going to have reproducibility, you have to think about all the provenance. And like the things that I commonly worry about, for example, in reduction. Suppose we did reduce your guys' data, and it could be any of these ECP technologies. Data, like probably Rob can tell you, data can live 100 years. I mean, and all of a sudden, we have a piece of software that was developed with a particular programming model, which was developed with GPUs that, I mean, I don't expect GPUs to live 100 years from now. And, you know, it's like, how does your data, how can you get back that data? And then when we think about further these online workflows, I mean, we do have to have enough provenance collection. We can record everything. There's an impact IO that could be done though. But the question is like, how would you guys use it? So I think, you know, for reproducible science, which is what I think all of us care about, and then reuse, you know, repurposing data. We don't want someone to repurpose climate data and say something that was interpreted wrong because the reduction, it did something to the data that was very unexpected and someone saw that. And, you know, these are things that a lot of us need to worry about. And that's why some of this is still, you know, in, you know, what we'll call research. But I would say we do have to worry about these issues.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Let me change the topic somewhat and just ask people, you know, you've been using a variety of tools, I assume, for data analysis, reduction, component coupling. So you know, what tools did you find useful for those purposes? You know, what did you use? What are there things you tried but didn't work? I know we don't like to talk about failures, but so you could focus on the first if you like, but both sorts of experiences are interesting, I think, to our listeners out in an ECP land. Oh, CS, you've got, you know, he's quick to.
Well, I just wanted to give you some of the example tools useful. Of course, Scott Klasky is Audios too, yeah, right? They're very useful in getting the data, say analysis data to analysis nodes using Audios, because we don't want to slow down the simulation doing the analysis in the main code. Main code, we usually make them scale very well, but analysis, some of them can be expensive and don't scale at all. So the whole simulation will have to stop while the analysis is going. And Audios has been a great tool in moving the data, uploading the data to independent analysis nodes to do that. And getting, you know, grid information, for example, the particle distribution function information, and preserving the feature. We have a MGuard and say autoencoder decoder, very useful with Dave's visit analysis, visualization and analysis. Those are very useful together with a few machine learning tools we are using.
All right, thank you. Axel?
Yeah, things that work and don't work. Remember the things that don't work. The things that work well for me is at the end, one thing that we also have to be aware of, the moment I integrate something in our application, I equate this in a really large stack. And I don't say like we have a million lines of code in our own language that would be easy, but it's like we're integrating with third parties and not only data reduction, but also other things like math libraries and so on and so on. And the challenge that I have with resilience data is I need to be able to access and analyze whatever the reduced data is on all kinds of platforms, not only HPC. And that's a thing that's quite often overlooked. That means I need to be able to compile this on the weird Mac that one of my colleagues has for development or analysis, and then you'll be able, even in DAO, to use this on a Windows machine. So package management is super important for us in integration, that we can at the end create a large software stack that has an application. Mm-hmm. So yeah, the moment that this happens, and the ACP is actually just plainly saying, ACP is really making a big step in that we have these common package managers, is a tremendous help for us. What somewhat works or doesn't work in these workflows, yeah, sometimes what's challenging, what we're still trying to figure out is how to use workflows where we try to quickly hide latency by moving things to a different memory location and then draining them somewhere else. That's challenging because it interferes with MPI or the same network resources. That sometimes works, but not all the time. And actually, that depends on the concrete application input that we have. Yeah.
Well, thank you. So I should ask now: are there we'd be delighted to take questions from the audience. Remind you can speak up if you're able to turn on. I think you should be able to unmute, or you can type things into the chat. Don't be shy.
I think there was a general question, if someone else wants to comment, from Tim. He was asking, because we initially talked a little about particle data, but if someone had like a field specific or like tree structure specific challenge, space bin curve or like mesh refinement. I answered a little bit on our mesh refinement aspects that we have, but maybe someone else wants to chime in as well. If you have field problems. So yes, do you have any problems with fields? They're also curvilinearly curved in your case.
Well, if you think of questions and bring them up if you want, but here's another one for our panelists in the meantime. So what's the biggest challenge that you see yourself facing over the next, the remainder of the ECP program and beyond? Where do you most need help with your, or you're not getting it with your applications in this area? So Scott needs help. Tell us.
I think all of us are all worried about what happens after ECP, what happens with the software, what happens with, but if I take this different, I'm just wondering, as we go further, as AI is integrated further with applications, and now we have this mixture of using things like PyTorch and TensorFlow and all this stuff with your MPI / CUDA / everything else application. I don't know the world that's going to bring, but it says, hey, there's hopefully enough for funds for us.
Yeah, so you raised, two important points. One is as we start to integrate in an increasingly broad range of techniques, including these new AI techniques, there are many software engineering challenges. And secondly, there's also, of course, resource challenges to make that work happen. Any other, does anyone else face any problems, or are you all as happy as can be and just... No, Axel. I've swear Axel to speak.
Help needed. First of all, I agree with the sustainability challenge. Currently we are in a good situation because we're still developing and we can address challenges as we adopt our software technology stack to new workflows and into new parts. But how do we continue with that, and will it stay sustainable after this is the question. One thing that's interesting for us is just thinking like full workflow up to the domain scientist is, specifically if you develop workflow languages for in situ reduction and continue to evolve them, how can we integrate them as seamlessly and as easy to learn as possible for the domain scientist, because the currently we have abstractions at multiple levels that how you like to describe our data reduction, our data transport, and so on. But at the end, we need to not only make this reproducible, but also learnable in a finite time. While the domain scientist also worries about a lot of other things, like is actually the simulation that I'm running actually resolving the science that I'm looking for? Is it actually giving me the result I'm looking for? Or do I have to run it again because I described everything wrongly? And so the question is, how easy can we make this? How can we standardize on this? How least exotic as possible can we do them? Can we script them in some way, maybe in an easy high-level language that people are familiar with? These are the things that I would like to push forward. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. CS.
Yeah, I have two concerns. One is data storage. The OLCF, ALCF, they don't want to store data, you know that. And that's one thing. As Scott says, it's going to last 10 years, and we're going to look back at the data 10 years ago. Where are we going to store this humongous exascale data? And that is one thing. The other thing is the data security policy between different computing centers. In many cases, would like to have two simulations going on at ALCF or OLCF. You want to get them into one system. We have to use one-time password, for example. We just can't do that continuously. So I have been raising this question. Isn't there any way to get some policy established so that at least there's a trust, there is some, I think they are working on some trust relationship. I think we need to enhance that capability between at least the DOE labs, not NNSA labs, but those are two, a little different scale concern I have.
So I'm good to hear that I'm glad to hear that you believe the ability to move data rapidly and reliably and securely between labs is important. So, and we've just finished an 8 petabyte transfer from Livermore to Argonne in Oak Ridge, actually, which was a fun thing to do, but point taken. So let's see, Rob, you have your...
I just want to reiterate or emphasize the point made about having a permanent reliable storage for some of these data sets that took millions of hours to generate and can be fruitfully mined for information for many years to a decade after they're made, and this community needs to know that they can where they can go get them reliably. And climate has been doing pretty well with this pattern where we make our data sets available and then people download what they need to do the analysis they want. I think, and that's been fine for the resolutions we've been running that, but one of the ways we're taking advantage of exascale is to run these dramatically higher storm resolving resolution models where I don't think that's going to work anymore. And I don't think we really have it's going to very quickly separate the haves from the have-nots of how people can get access to that data.
Interesting, right. So the model has long been really offline analysis. You actually move it to your home institution, and now you need varying forms of online. So we're almost at the top of the hour. Maybe I thought I'd give everyone just a minute to express any final thought that they have they haven't had a chance to express, and maybe we can go in reverse order this time. So, Arvin, can we ask you first, any final remarks?
No, I think everything was, I think all of these concerns are like great, considerations for such workflows, especially complex workflows that have these types of, heterogeneity in devices, heterogeneity in software, heterogeneity in data. And I think it brings to bear the, bare minimum stuff that we need to support for these types of workflows. Transfer of large data sets is actually fine, but transfer of models, for example, Facebook just released its, 175 billion parameter model and so on, but it's still a huge problem in terms of like downloading the weights and trying to figure out whether, 4 nodes on Perlmutter is going to be sufficient or 8 nodes on, Frontier is going to be sufficient, or one node on Aurora is going to be sufficient. There's a lot of questions around those sort of things. And so, and then the low precision models, again, that's another story that I think requires its own discussion. But
okay,
you know, how do we deal with,
yep,
deal with this? So,
okay, next, Scott, your last remarks, your last words.
They're not going to be my last, but for this, it will be. But what I was going to say, so we started out by all this is online, and it's what I call the data in motion problem. And we kind of said, okay, then that all goes, you do your science, it gets pushed from the file system. But where I think the next step, if there was a CODAR 2.0, I would say, now let's think of it in the reverse order, that now the data, it's distributed. I want to be able to read it. I want to be able to reduce it as I read it, because maybe I, you know, maybe Rob has his laptop, CS has, you know, a supercomputer in his pocket, and we all have our different resources. And how do we do that in a timely fashion? So going from storage back to where we want to do now our post-processing or analytics, how do we do that in these new ways? What new technology? So that's the thing that excites me in the future, mm-hmm, because, you know, it's not just we're doing it as data is being generated, it's also coming back. So I'm asking the question back, how do we take a lot of these technologies and come back? Yes, I'm done.
We've got 3 minutes. So Rob, a few sentences or one sentence, whatever. Yeah.
One of your questions was, where will in situ viz ever be a real thing? I think it might actually be for these storm resolving models, because watching a regular climate model run is very boring, but these storm resolving models have so much detail and run for short amounts of simulated time that I think it will be useful to use in situ viz for development, certainly, and even for production runs.
Thank you. Axel?
Yeah, that's a good question. Going forward, in order to realize the question that we have, it's time to start already and to continue to communicate what are actually the directions we want to analyze from the science case, because that is exactly the change that arises. And think about it, like, what if we get another 10x loss in flop per bandwidth that we get out of the mm-hmm system? And what was actually your workflow? I think thinking from the thing is, what are we trying to do? Do we try to explore something? Do we try to optimize something? And then communicating that across sciences, from computational physics, computational chemistry, biology, to computer sciences, and is essential. And I'm quite grateful that so many people here in the panel, but also audience, are already doing this with us. And I hope that we can continue that, because that's the way forward, I think.
Good, thank you. And CS, you're the last word, except I've got one sentence.
Oh, no, I let you have the last word. I don't have anything more.
Well, all I'm going to say is thank you all very much for engaging in this process, I think. And, you know, I think we thought we'd try this process of not having people give talks with slides, but do a more interactive Q&A, and I think it worked very well. So thank you. And thank you also to the audience and to those who asked questions on the chat. We look forward to seeing you, some of you, in person, perhaps at the next year's ECP, if not before. So enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you very much. That was very nice.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Bye. Thanks so much. See you soon.